I'll tell you that much. That's all I got to say. And I hope everyone here does too, because we had standing room only.
Steal by guess who? Dal Smith.
In the fall of 1990, the Scarlet Knights of Rutgers began a glorious quest for supremacy in the Atlantic 10 Conference. Once upon a time, they had been a Cinderella story, but this season would be no fairy tale. They confidently confronted the intense competition and adversity that lies on the rocky road to the NCAA tournament. In 1990-91, these brave knights wrote a daring tale of action and adventure while claiming their place as the dominant team in the Atlantic 10. Rutgers Basketball, the championship quest. It all begins with Midnight Madness.
We want a good season, a winning season. We want our players to do their best.
Officially, it's the first day of practice. In reality, it's a celebration of Rutgers spirit.
Midnight Madness was a tremendous way to kick it off. And I'll never forget, 11:55, waiting out, right out behind the bleachers, and the lights were turned out, and then coach announced the players' names. Coming out there with the spotlight on you, it was just an incredible feeling.
The excitement of Midnight Madness was intensified by the reality that Rutgers would open the season on national television against highly ranked Missouri.
Everybody had high expectations for that game. Everybody was real pumped for the game. I mean, coach had us really psyched and really ready for the game. So going into Midnight Madness and knowing that we were playing Missouri on national TV, the first game of the year, really it set a scene for the rest of the season to come.
Defense starts it off, okay? Play with gusto, gentlemen. Get after it.
A year ago, Rutgers pushed the number one Tigers to the limit at Missouri. This year, at home in the rack, it would be a different story.
When you write the script for a game like that, you wouldn't write it exactly as it happened. Brent Dabbs, who was our starting center, it would have been his first game, was injured 3 days before the game. So now we're playing Missouri without our starting center. So Charlie Weiler, who's a freshman, came in to be the starter.
Freshman Charlie Weiler played with the confidence of a veteran, holding his own against Missouri's experienced front line. An all-out pressing defense handcuffed the Tigers' scorers and unleashed the Knights' fast-break offense. Rutgers forced a stunning 28 Missouri turnovers on the way to a resounding 68-60 victory. The Knights had taken the first step toward meeting the preseason expectations.
The good thing about it is it started the season off with a bang, and people were there, and it was a packed crowd as we've had, and so the enthusiasm for the season got off to a great start right away.
The Scarlet Knights rode a crest of confidence generated by the Missouri win to five straight victories, giving them their best start ever under Coach Bob Wenzel. The catalyst for their success was all-conference forward Keith Hughes. Known as the constant factor, Keith had the rare ability to take over a game at any time.
He's got the attitude of a winner, without a doubt. Regardless of what his skills are, as whether he's a better outside shooter or inside player, he just got the attitude to go out there and do what it takes to win the game. And for us last year, there's no doubt that was one of the single most important factors leading to our success.
Quite simply, Keith Hughes did it all. He led the break, knocked down the three, and controlled the boards. Many times he carried the team on his shoulders. He led the conference in both shooting percentage and intensity on his way to becoming an NBA second round draft pick. There could be no better choice for Atlantic 10 Player of the Year than the Scarlet Knights' Keith Hughes.
I'll always remember his work ethic, his business approach to what we were doing in basketball, his sarcastic wit, and the fact that here's a guy who went to Syracuse and transferred to Rutgers, and a person who did well in school and whose career blossomed here.
Sometimes it's through adversity that a team finds its true character. Early on, injuries would plague the Scarlet Knights. Then, coming off three straight losses in December, the Knights faced Western Athletic Conference champion BYU in the Holiday Festival Tournament at Madison Square Garden. They responded with the courage of a champion, dominating on both ends of the court. With 24 points from Keith Hughes and 19 from center Brent Dabbs, Rutgers coasted to an 85-70 victory, sending a message to the Atlantic 10 that the Knights were ready for the tough conference schedule ahead. The leading rebounder against BYU was Brent Dabbs. After missing the first two games of the year with an ankle injury, he quickly developed into the Atlantic 10's newcomer of the year.
Rebound to Jones. Here's a fast break. Dabbs goes in, and he slaps it home.
Dabbs was at his best in conference games, especially against West Virginia. He wore out the Mountaineers with 19 points in Morgantown and 17 rebounds at the rack. In that 75-71 Rutgers victory, West Virginia became another victim of the Scarlet Knights' rack pack, the Rutgers home court advantage. They found out why the Lewis Brown Athletic Center is quickly gaining a reputation as one of the toughest places to play in all of college basketball.
Just having that sixth man there, just having the rack pack, just having everything. The fan support is phenomenal, and just having, just coming out to hearing the crowd cheer for you every day, every home game, it just uplifts you every game.
In 1990-91, Rutgers basketball attracted the biggest crowds in its history, breaking all previous home attendance records. The fan support was rewarded with superlative performances on the court. Their sterling 14-4 overall conference record was the finest in school history. In January, the Scarlet Knights began what would become their longest winning streak in Atlantic 10 history, with 9 consecutive victories over conference opponents. The streak launched this team right to the top of the Atlantic 10 Conference.
One, two, three, go!
February began at the rack with a grudge match against arch-rival Temple. The Knights were not about to be pushed around.
We look forward to playing Temple every year. They're especially the last two or three years, they've been the team to shoot for. Either they have been the team to shoot for, or we've been the team to shoot for. So, you know, the matches between Temple and Rutgers have always been long awaited.
Although long awaited, this time the outcome was never in doubt. Rutgers dominated every aspect of the game, blowing Temple away in an impressive 19-point victory. It kept the Knights straight on course to their ultimate destination, the Atlantic 10 Championship. Senior guards Earl Duncan and Craig Carter were the glue that held this team together. Carter is the team's fifth all-time leader in assists. Duncan, a second-team all-conference selection, ran the offense while averaging more than 15 points per game. They were the perfect complement to sophomore guard Mike Jones, whose 18 points were instrumental in the Knights' 87-70 victory over conference rival Rhode Island. In the front court, Donnell Lumpkin, a member of the Atlantic 10's all-freshman team a year ago, continued to mature. Junior forward Darryl Smith, although slowed by an early season injury, developed into one of the night's most exciting players. With just two games remaining in the regular season, Rutgers needed a sweep of both Penn State and Massachusetts to ensure sole possession of the Atlantic 10 Championship.
This season, Penn State and Massachusetts were two of the better teams in the league. Penn State went to the NCAA, beat UCLA, and Massachusetts went to the Final Four of the NIT. And we had to beat both of those teams. Fortunately, we had won on the road against both of them, and the last two games were at home, and the scene was set.
This game had it all. An Atlantic 10 television audience, a sold-out arena, and a conference championship at stake. The game even went into overtime. On this day, the seniors took center stage. Brent Dabbs and Earl Duncan both played with the heart of a champion. Keith Hughes led the way with 33 points and a season-high 16 rebounds. Massachusetts fought back to force an overtime, but Rutgers took control in the extra period and won 103-96. With one arm now wrapped around the conference trophy, Rutgers would not be denied. They went on to defeat Penn State handily, 92-70, and once again were crowned Atlantic 10 Conference champions. Yeah!
chosen
at the beginning of the year to win the league, and they won the league, which is a far cry from 2 years ago when we were picked to finish last, and we came in third, and then we won the league championship in the league tournament. That there was a whole different feeling about this team. The first team was a Cinderella story. This team was, hey, you're supposed to be good. Let's see you prove it. And that's exactly what they did.
It was the second conference championship for head coach Bob Wenzel in just 3 years. The Scarlet Knights had fulfilled their promise of success, winning 14 conference games, including 11 of their last 12, and receiving their third straight postseason tournament invitation. Their rewards came from talent, hard work, and a belief in themselves. They were champions in every sense of the word.